Isaiah chapter 52 is a fitting prelude to probably the most famous chapter of the book, Isaiah chapter 53. And though 53 is so famous because it exclusively discusses the suffering of the Messiah, largely involved his trial and his crucifixion, chapter 52 does not shy away from talking about the suffering Savior either. The last few verses of the chapter are just as vivid in their imagery as chapter 53 is. But that's only the end of chapter 52. Really, the beginning of it is a step-by-step building toward that moment. And as you look at chapter 52, it's only 15 verses long, but you can still divide it up into three very distinct sections. The first half dozen verses discuss how bad captivity is and how much the people want to get out of it. The next six verses, verses 7 through 12, deal with the greatness of life after captivity, which is the life that comes in the era of the Messiah, and the blessings that follow the people out of captivity. And then the final three verses, 13 through 15, discuss the high price that had to be paid to purchase their freedom from captivity. And we'll consider those three parts as we look through this chapter, but it starts in verse 1 of Isaiah 52, which picks up right where the previous chapter left off. In the previous chapter of 51, God had been told, or called by the people, called upon by the people to awaken, to wake up and to be stirred and to free them from captivity. And then God basically explained to them that he was wide awake, he knew exactly what was going on, but he wasn't going to come save them yet, because it wasn't time for them to come out of captivity yet. They had to suffer and learn their lesson. Then he turned to them and told them to wake up, because they had been drunk on their sinfulness and drunk on the fury of God's anger against them. Chapter 52 continues that thought, with God again telling his people to wake up. 52 verse 1 says, "Awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come unto thee the uncircumcised and the unclean." You're going to suffer and suffer and suffer, and then one day I'm going to say to you, wake up, get dressed, it's time to go home. It's time to put on your best garments, O Zion, put on your strength, stand with boldness, because you're marching out of this captive place and you're going home. You're not going to have to deal with the unclean things of Babylon anymore, the uncircumcised things of Babylon anymore. You can go home. Verse 2, "Shake thyself from the dust, arise and sit down. If you're sitting and you're chained, unchain yourself and stand up. If you're standing and you're chained, unchain yourself and sit down for a moment and relax. Whatever you need to do to free yourself, I've made it possible for you to free yourself. So arise, sit down, but Jerusalem, loose yourself from the bands of your neck, O captive daughter of Zion." You're freed. This horrible, desolate exile of captivity is coming to an end. I'm calling on you now to be freed. "For thus says the Lord, you have sold yourselves for naught, and you shall be redeemed without money." Earlier, several chapters ago, back in chapter 49:24, Judah asked the question, how can God free us when we were legally captured? When we were, by all geopolitical laws, we were lawfully conquered and put in captivity. So how can God free us? His answer then was by capturing the captors through Persia and capturing Babylon, I'll free you. Here he looks at it from a different perspective. He says to his people, you weren't stolen from me. You weren't taken from me unwillingly. I gave you up. I turned you over. Because you were so wicked and sinful, I let you go into captivity. I handed you over for free, for nothing, for naught. So I can just as easily take you back for nothing. You're going to be redeemed. Not with nothing, notice he says, but for no money. I'm not going to buy you back. There'll be a different price paid. We'll get to later. Verse 4. "For thus says the Lord God, my people went down aforetime into Egypt to sojourn there, and the Assyrian oppressed them without cause." And just the beginning of verse 5. "Now therefore, what have I here?" In other words, there have been three times in the history of God's people when they've been put in captivity. First, most famously, Egypt. Exodus captivity, Egyptian captivity. They went and sojourned there. They were invited there by Joseph, the right-hand man of Pharaoh. So they went there. It started out good, and it ended up bad. So God freed them. Then the northern kingdom, after the split of the nation, went to Assyrian captivity. That was all bad. They were punished entirely, given up, and turned over by God. and cast away, divorced by him, as he said a few chapters ago. So all bad was Assyrian captivity. Babylonian captivity, it's bad, but it turns out good, because it's going to lead to a positive thing. It's going to lead to the bloated, sinful nation being reduced to a more pure, lean, mean, holy machine. And so God says in verse 5, "What have I here? Says the Lord. My people taken away for nothing." You didn't have to go into captivity. The north, they deserved every ounce of punishment. You didn't have to. You chose to go to captivity because you chose not to listen to me. I warned you and begged you and pleaded with you, but you chose to sin. So you went for nothing. "That they may rule over you and make you howl, says the Lord. And my name continually every day is blasphemed." And while you're in captivity, what do? As they whip you and as they abuse you, you blaspheme me. I mean, at the very least, curse your oppressors. Don't curse me. But while they're in captivity, they're on the one hand calling for God to free them, previous chapter verse 9, and at the other hand, they're cursing God for all the suffering they're enduring. So these people don't deserve to be freed. And until they learn that lesson, that God is their ultimate protector, until they totally turn over to Him, He won't free them. As he says in verse 6, "Therefore my people shall know my name." When they finally do acknowledge me, when they finally recognize me and turn back to me, then I'll free them. "Therefore shall they know in that day," the day I free them, "that I am He that does speak. Behold, it is I." You will learn your lesson. That's why you're being punished. You will endure the suffering, and then you'll be cut down and reduced until only the faithful ones remain, and they call on me to save them. And those who do will be saved by me. They'll know my name. And in that day, they'll know who it is that saved them. And that's the first section of the chapter. The harshness of captivity, God is saying to his people, get up, it's time to go home. Who's going to hear that message? Those faithful few. And those faithful few are going to return home. And verses 7 through 12 talk about how great it is, how wonderful it is that they're going to be free. There's a lot of parallels you can find in this section between Babylonian freedom and spiritual freedom. Exile in Babylon and exile to sin. Freedom from one and freedom from the other. One's physical, one's spiritual. They parallel each other greatly in this text. But it starts with Romans 10, where the Apostle Paul wrote about how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and take the message to the world. He got that idea from Isaiah 52, verse 7, where the prophet says, "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of them that bring good tidings, that publish peace, that bring good tidings of good, that publish salvation, that say unto Zion, thy God reigns." How beautiful are the feet of those messengers who carry the message of salvation, who carry the good news that we're freed, we get to go home. That message of God in the first part of the chapter is spread like wildfire to the whole people. And how beautiful are the feet of those messengers who deliver that good news. There's a contrast here, if you want to find it, in Proverbs 6:18 and this text here, where in Proverbs 6, God is talking about things that he hates, and he mentions feet that are swift to do evil. Well, here are feet that are swift to bring good news. Those are feet that God loves, feet that are beautiful, that publish peace, that preach the sermons of salvation and publish salvation and say unto Zion, your God reigns. God reigns. We're freed. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So they're on the mountaintops shouting for joy. At the bottom of the mountain is the watchman, verse 8. The watchman shall lift up the voice. With the voice together shall they sing. They will sing together in harmony. Everyone singing from the mountaintops when Zion is singing of their salvation, and the watchmen at the bottom of the mountain, the whole rest of the world, they will hear the message of salvation, and they will hear it up here and down here, and they'll sing it together in harmony. Everybody being saved all over the world. Lift up their voice together, and they'll sing, for they shall see eye to eye, Jew and Gentile, together as one in the church of Christ. When the Lord shall bring again his people to Zion. Zion, in this case, the church of the Lord. Spiritual Zion, the spiritual nation of God. So break forth into joy. Sing together, you waste places of Jerusalem. My captive people, sing, come home. For the Lord comforts his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. How wonderful is this? We've been redeemed. So we're singing. What are we singing exactly? What is the song that we sing? Verse 10. That the Lord may bare his holy arm. We're singing and we're happy that God rolled up his sleeves. That God got to work and did the things that we could not do for ourselves. He may bare his holy arm. And in the eyes of all the nations, everybody will see God working for us. And all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of the Lord. So God rolled up his sleeves. He got to work. He weaved this plan. He worked out this plan that led to our salvation. Again, parallel. Salvation from Babylon, yes. But ultimately, salvation from sin is the discussion here. Verse 11. Depart ye, go out from thence. Touch no unclean thing. Go out from the midst of her. Be clean that bear the vessels of the Lord. So go out from Babylon. Yes, leave this place, depart. Touch no unclean thing. Have nothing to do with this Gentile nation anymore. Be clean, be pure in the sight of God. Bear the vessels of the Lord. Take those holy artifacts that were stolen from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar. Bring them back to Jerusalem. At the same time, depart from sin. Depart from sin. Go out from unholiness. Don't be unclean spiritually anymore. Go out from the midst of wickedness, be clean, and bear the cross of Jesus Christ and follow him. Bear that holy vessel and follow it to eternal reward. Verse 12, for you shall not go out with haste, nor by flight. You people who are being freed from Babylon, you're not going to break out like breaking out of prison. You're not going to go out in haste. You're not going to retreat like cowards in flight. You're going to stand and proudly march out. You've won through God. For the Lord will go before you. The God of Israel will be your re-reward. The word means your protector. God is the reason. He's the Moses here. He's the one leading you through this Exodus and carrying you out at Babylon. So you're not going to sneak out in the middle of the night. You're not going to run and retreat. You're going to walk out. You're going to have victory. And so you're going to sing victory. This is wonderful. We've been redeemed. This is great. God has saved us. Who do we have to thank? What was the price paid? How did God accomplish this? Verse 13, behold. Behold. Pay attention to this. My servant. Now, Judah might think that she's the servant of God, but she doesn't match up to the descriptions applied here. My servant shall deal prudently. This servant of God will be very wise and will do his job perfectly. The job that will culminate in the salvation of all mankind. He shall be exalted and extolled, literally high and lifted up. It's the exact same Hebrew words applied to Jehovah in Isaiah 6:1 when Isaiah says, in the year the king Uzziah died, I saw Jehovah high and lifted up. And his train filled the temple. I saw God high and lifted up. Whom did he see? The servant, the Messiah to come. Exalted and extolled, and he shall be very high. Literally, he shall soar above. So this is a high and exalted divine being, this servant. Not Judah. Not the lowly, sin-stricken people, but the sinless, perfect Son of God. This is the high and lifted up Son of God we're talking about here. And he says he's high and lifted up. Philippians 2:9, a name given above every name, or Hebrews 1:3, he is placed above all creation. And yet, verse 14, many were astonished, shocked, startled, amazed in a negative sense, horror struck at him. His visage, his appearance, was so marred, so disfigured, more than any man. And his form, so disfigured, more than all the sons of men, all of humanity put together. So though this is a divine being, God, who is high and lifted up above everything, as a person, he is beaten down and broken down and so abused, so much more than any man ever could be. Look at the dichotomy. He deserves great stature and honor, high and lifted up, but he will be abased, abused, defeated, but not destroyed. Willingly, he will be those things. Humbly, He will be those things. He allows himself to be those things. God, divine, but a servant, man, the God-man. Verse 15. So shall he, the King James says, sprinkle. The word ought to be startle. It's a parallel to the previous verse. Startle many nations. The kings shall shut their mouths at him. At the news of what this one individual goes through, even leaders, rulers, who are supposed to have calm demeanors and be able to handle major crises, when they hear what he'll go through, they will cover their mouths in shock. For that which had not been told them shall they see. They'll hear about him things they've never heard before, what he went through. That which they had heard or had never heard shall they consider. They've never seen anything like this. They've never heard of anything like this. And yet they'll hear about it because the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ will go across the whole world, and many of these leaders will consider it and some will obey it. And that is just our first little taste of the suffering servant. The rest of it we'll pick up in chapter 53. The apex of perhaps the entire Old Testament is in the next chapter, which we'll cover next time. Until then, thank you very much.